So, today we're going to start the second class on the book review of No Solar, the basis of the movie Astral City. No Solar in Portuguese again means our home. And we're going to talk about the lower realms, lower zones, is the term they've used in the book for that. The first portion of the story of Dr. Luiz and what was transmitted to Francisco Xavier. And I will come in with commentary after Brent goes through chapters 1, 12, and 44 with the Buddhist perspective, or a Buddhist perspective, on the lower realms. And that's an interesting comparison. So take it away, Brent.
Okay. Thank you, Scott. Yes, I have supplied once again the web address for the PDF file of Astral City, in case nobody has downloaded it, or you neglected to, or you don't want to download it. You can link up to it at the address I just supplied. As Scott mentioned, today we're going to do chapters 1, 12, and 44. So we're going to begin chapter 1, which is on page 16 of the book, if you're following along. And I am basically going to read the first chapter in its entirety because I believe it's that important. It's an excellent description of what actually happened to André Luiz right after his physical death. Chapter 1, In the Lower Zones. I was under the impression that I had lost all notion of time and space. I was convinced that I no longer belonged to the world of the living, yet I continued to inhale deep breaths of air. Since when had I become the puppet of irresistible forces? I could not say. I felt like a prisoner, trapped in the dark cage of horror, with my hair on end, my heart thumping uncontrollably, a prey to terrible fear. Many times I shouted like a raving lunatic. I begged for mercy and clamored against the bitter despondency which had taken hold of my spirit. But my cries fell on only silence, or were answered by lamenting voices still more moving than my own. At other times, sinister roars of laughter rent the stillness, as if some unknown companion must be close by me, a prisoner of insanity. Diabolical forms, ghastly faces, bestial countenances crossed my way from time to time, increasing my panic. The scenery, when it was not pitch dark, was bathed in a lurid light, as if shrouded in a thick fog warmed by the sun's rays. Thus I proceeded on that strange journey. To what end? Who could say? I only knew that I kept fleeing. Fright drove me on blindly. Where were my home, my wife, my children? I had lost all sense of direction. The fear of the unknown and my dread of darkness had annulled all my powers of reasoning from the very moment I had broken free of my physical body in the grave. My conscience tormented me. I would have preferred the total absence of reason or non-existence. Copious tears ran constantly down my cheeks, and only rarely was I blessed with a few minutes of sleep. What rest I had was often interrupted as monstrous beings awoke me and mocked me, and I was obliged to go on fleeing. I saw now that I was on a different plane of life, which rose from the emanations of the earth. But it was too late. Anguish weighed heavily on my mind, and when I started making plans for action, numerous incidents would lead me on to bewildering avenues of thought. Never had the religious question loomed so large before my eyes. Principles purely political, philosophical, and scientific now seemed to me of secondary importance to human life. Although they were valuable acquisitions on Earth, I had to admit that mankind was not made of transitory generations, but of immortal spirits on their ascension to a glorious destination. I was beginning to realize the existence of one thing that stands above all that is material or intellectual: faith. A divine manifestation to man. Such an analysis, however, came too late. It is true that I was familiar with the Old Testament and often read through the Gospels, but I was forced to recognize that I had never searched the sacred writings. with the light of my heart. I had embraced the interpretations of writers who were not inclined to sentiments and conscience, and who were at times even in open disagreement with the fundamental truths. On other occasions, I had taken to an ecclesiastical point of view, entering voluntarily into a circle of contradictions. In truth, I did not believe that I was a criminal in my life, though my philosophy of living for the immediate present had absorbed me fully. My earthly life, now transformed by death, had been no different from the life of so many others. Born perhaps excessively generous parents, I had graduated from the university without much effort and shared the dissipation and vices of the youth of my time. Later, when I married and started a family, I was blessed with children, gained a stable, lucrative position, and was spared off all financial worries. Yet on self-examination, I feel deeply that I had wasted time, and I now hear the silent pangs of my conscience. I had lived on earth, enjoyed its benefits, reaped the good things of life, and yet never contributed anything towards the repayment of my heavy debt. I had completely ignored my parents' generosity and sacrifices, just as I had ignored those of my wife and children. I had selfishly kept my family only to myself. I had been given a happy home and had closed my doors to those seeking help. I had delighted in the joys of my family circle, yet never shared that precious gift with my greater human family. I had neglected to undertake even the most elementary duties of fraternal solidarity. Now that my life was over, I was like a hothouse plant, unable to withstand the weather of eternal realities. I had not cultivated the divine seeds of the Father of Life had sown in my soul. They were choked by the weeds of my insatiable desire for comfort and enjoyment. I had not trained my faculties for this new life. It was only right then that I should enter it like a cripple, thrown into the infinite river of eternity, unable to swim, or like a wretched beggar at the end of his strength, wandering about in the middle of a stormy desert. Oh, dear friends on earth, how many of you may still avoid the bitter road of sorrow by cultivating the inner fields of your heart? Light up your lamp before crossing the threshold of the shadows. Search for truth, lest the truth find you unprepared. Sweat and toil now, lest you weep afterwards. Now, the only thing that I would say that I would take away from chapter one, as far as important points are concerned, and we go on in greater detail in the next two chapters, is what the lower zones are like. But first, interesting, he noted that he lost all notion of time and space. He was aware that he no longer had a physical body somehow, yet he continued to inhale deep breaths of air. He felt, quote, a puppet of irresistible forces and prey to terrible fears. Fright drove him on blindly, and his conscience tormented him greatly. So there we go. Scott, do you have any points to add to the introduction of the first chapter?
Yeah, absolutely. This, you know, his description of how he lived his physical life doesn't seem to be so evil or harmful to others. It seems just materialistic and selfish, more or less. There are a lot of people who have materialist worldview and are selfish, more or less. We're all selfish a little bit, somewhat, more or less. Is that enough to land everybody into hell? No, I don't think so. One thing the movie talked about that maybe is not in here, in obviously not chapter one, is that when he was in, at least in the movie, in this hell realm, people were calling him a suicide. And he, as you'll probably explain later, Brent, was a heavy drinker, it seems, or hurt himself by alcohol. And that, you've got in this book his account of his life based on his own level of evolution and his prior spiritual training, which is a bit limited. So his explanation of process and causation is also going to be limited. Everything's limited, but we're hoping to be a little less limited here. He not only had not cultivated divine seeds, the father of life and sown in his soul, meaning he didn't put much effort to the development of green and blue and indigo. He didn't put much effort, particularly into being a good person to the people around him. He said, I had not trained my faculties for the new life, for this new life. That's common. That's certainly universal with people who have a materialist worldview. And yet, not everybody who's a materialist worldview goes to hell or has a stint in hell. My sense is that he probably had more aggression than he's willing to admit here, or at this level of his description and story, he's not in touch with how he was an actively harmful force during his life. It's not common selfishness or basic self-centeredness that lands beings in hell. It's not materialist worldview that does. It's generally going to be aggression and harm to self and other. Drinking to the point of pathology of body, alcoholism, drug addiction, abuse, that level of activity usage is aggression against self or body. And wrong speech is generally going to be that aggression towards other. And sharing the dissipation and vices of the youth of his time, I don't think itself also is a problem that lands people in hell. It's not, obviously, a saintly life. But not everybody who dies goes to hell. It's very much the axis upon which turns the question of whether a being will go to one of the hells or not after death is, I think, primarily aggression. And he may have had more of it than he presented here in chapter 1. Let me bring some material here from a Wikipedia page on Buddhist cosmology. So I sent everybody a link there. Down the middle of the page, there are two sections I'd like to look into. One is called Pretaloka, and the other one is called the Hells. Pretaloka, which we looked into in the Views Action Path series at the beginning, as Gandhaba, or the intermediate state between human and physical incarnation and the next incarnation, or between death and birth, is not the same as hell dwelling. And the description here of Pretaloka, or Preta, or Peta, depends if it's Pali or Sanskrit, is hungry ghost, right? That's one of the six realms. The three lower realms, or states of woe, are hell, hungry ghost, and the asuras, which to me equates to 4D negative, which is not lower, but it's woeful. And the negatives in the world are quite woeful, whether they admit it or not. But hell realm is not the same as hungry ghost. In Buddhist cosmology, metaphysically, there is a sense that when desire and greed get too strong, material attachment to material pleasure, sensual pleasure, one may become a preta or hungry ghost. When aggression gets too strong, one may have a stint in hell. When ignorance gets too heavy, one may be reborn as an animal, though again, I don't think that's so common. And so, the Pretaloka, for the most part, live in deserts and wastelands. Not the same as what we see where Andre Luiz is experiencing. He was in perhaps one of the cold hells. And the description on this page of Naraka, or Niraya, Niraya is Pali, Naraka is Sanskrit, and I'll just read it and explain. The name given to one of the worlds of greatest suffering, translated in English as hell or purgatory, more so that the cold realms are closer to purgatory and the hot hells are associated more with hell and, you know, fire and brimstone. As with other realms, a being is born into one of these worlds as a result of his karma and resides there for a finite length of time until his karma has achieved its full result. after which he'll be reborn in one of the higher worlds as a result of earlier karma that has not yet ripened. That's a very important point. And so that's, there are two, Wikipedia covered it, I think on this page or the other page. There are two main differences between the Buddhist conception of karma, which is extremely harmonious with the Spiritist or Dr. Louise's story's account of cosmology and karmic process. The Buddhist view is different, or the Buddhist and, let's say, Spiritist view, which are very similar, although the Buddhist seems to be much more developed, actually, in cosmology and metaphysical explanation. Different from the Christian or the exoteric outer Christian Islam, Judaic, so the Abrahamic religions coming out of Abraham, right? Judaism, Christianity, Islam. Exoteric versions, not eso, not esoteric for initiates, the exoteric, have the sense that God will reward or punish, and one's reward or punishment in heaven or hell is eternal, static, forever, that's it, game over. You stay forever, it's all over. It just doesn't make sense, frankly, and it's really, there are lots and lots of people who left organized religion because it just doesn't make sense. It's just irrational and unfair, actually. A person believes a certain doctrine and lives, you know, somewhat selfish and somewhat kindly, and they go to heaven forever. A person hurts others or what? Has sex before marriage or drinks? Or what? Uses green tea in Mormonism? And then they go to hell forever? I don't think so. And so, that's a very big difference, and it's explained here clearly, where a stint in hell is the incarnative, the karmic result, karma, kama vipaka, the vipaka consequence of certain causes. And that particularly, the mentality, it writes here, the mentality of a being in hell corresponds to states of extreme fear and helpless anguish in humans. And so, it isn't extreme fear and anguish that got him in, but it's extreme fear and helpless anguish that he was feeling, that all the beings there are feeling. And as the hells go from cold to hot, the suffering increases, the length of time there increases, the experience of its interminability, meaning how long it's going on, how terrible and how hopeless and how it just seems to never end, increases. And again, being a materialist doesn't get you here, but being strongly selfish, being strongly unloving in relation to others, and particularly aggression by speech and behavior, gets you there. And he was probably in one of these cold hells associated with shivering and kind of a wasteland feeling. And so Brent's going to go on, and we're going to go further and explain what the Spiritist perspective on how beings get into the lower zones and what that's all about, and come back to the comparison with Buddhism. So, Brent?
Okay, thank you, Scott. In the next chapter, it's on page 56, chapter 12, The Lower Zone. This is still in the section, the early part of the book, where Andre is still busy going through his healing process, and he has an attendant companion that is helping him on a daily basis through his healing. Who visits him every day and gives him treatments and healing, well, basically just healing treatments and also discussion and training. And his name is Lysias, L-Y-S-I-A-S. At the very beginning, I'm going to skip just a little bit of it because Andre is reminiscing about some of the things that he's already been taught. And jumping down a sentence, he says, his, meaning Lysias's, reference to spirits in the shadowy lower zones aroused my curiosity. the lack of religious instruction on Earth is very often the cause of a serious state of confusion over here, as Scott just mentioned, which is quite true. Would the lower zone be? He was completely unaware that he just came out of a lower zone. He's still learning about the lower zone. Going on, I had heard hell and purgatory mentioned in the Roman Catholic sermons. I had attended out of social obligation, but never had the slightest notion of the lower zone. The next time I met my amiable attendant, I had all of my questions at my fingertips. He listened carefully and then replied, "Well, now how can you be unaware of that region when you were kept there for so long?" With a shudder of horror, I recalled my past sufferings. Lysis continued, and I'll mention right here in another section of another chapter, Lysis does discuss with Andre that he did spend 8 years in the lower realms, and Andre was quite shocked. He had no idea that it had been that long in the lower realms. As he mentioned earlier, he lost all track of space and time. Continuing, Lysis continues, the lower zone begins on the Earth's crust. It is the shadowy zone for those who, in the world, turn a deaf ear to the call of their sacred duties, which they fail to fulfill, languishing instead in indecision or dragging themselves into the mire of wrongdoings. You see, on reincarnating, a spirit promises to carry out the mission assigned to him in the Father's work. Yet, when he recommences his experiences, he finds it very difficult to keep his word. Instead, he blindly follows the dictates of his own selfishness. Thus, he continues to cultivate old hates and passions, forgetting that hatred is not justice, just as passion is not love. All that is superfluous and useless, unbalances the harmony of life. My apologies for some of the translation. Some of these sentences we have to kind of just work with, because the translation is an amateur translation, and we'll just read it as it's written. Going on, after physical death, great multitudes of obsessed entities remain in that misty region adjacent to the Earth's physical sphere. A well-accomplished duty serves as a gateway through which we enter the infinite. It brings us closer toward our goal, the sacred union with the Lord. It is natural, then, that one who neglects the tasks allotted to him should have that blessing indefinitely postponed. Lysias perceived my difficulty in grasping the full meaning of the lesson, owing to my almost total ignorance of spiritual principles, and tried to make it more objective. Now suppose that each of us returned to the earth wearing filthy clothing in order to wash it in the waters of human life. Our dirty garment is our spirit body, molded by our own hands in past lives. Although we are granted the blessing of a new opportunity on earth, we generally forget our essential aim. Instead of cleansing ourselves through constructive efforts, we acquire even more stains, we incur heavier debts, and imprison ourselves through our own actions. We return to the world to rid ourselves of our impurities, knowing that they are utterly inconsistent with the higher spheres. How then can we expect to enter those luminous spheres in an even worse condition? The lower zone is a place where negative mental residues are destroyed. It is a sort of purgatory where the refuse of the illusions acquired by neglecting the sublime opportunity of an earthly life is gradually burned away. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? The image could not have been clearer or more convincing. I was simply lost in amazement. Lysias, perceiving how useful these explanations could be to me, went on. The lower zone should be a region of great interest to those still on the physical plane, for it contains everything which is out of tune with the higher plane. Consider how wise divine providence was in allowing the creation of such a plane around Earth. There we find compact legions of irresolute and ignorant souls, not wicked enough to be relegated to colonies of harder expiation, nor sufficiently virtuous to be admitted to higher planes. Those countless inhabitants of the lower zone are close companions to incarnate men, separated from them only by vibratory laws. It is no wonder, then, that such places are characterized by serious disturbances. There, Rebellious spirits of all kinds are grouped together, forming invisible nuclei of extraordinary power, owing to the concentration of their common tendencies and desires. Many people on Earth become desperate when the postman doesn't turn up or when the train is late. The lower zone is full of such desperate creatures who, after physical death, are disappointed at not finding the Lord ready to satisfy their every whim. When they realize that the crown of glory and eternal life are awarded only to those who have worked with the Father, they show themselves as they truly are, wasting precious time on petty deeds in the lower zone. Just as in the astral city, entities in the lower zone form a spiritual community, but their community is peopled with many different types of frustrated, idle, and perverse entities. It is the threshold, a zone of tyranny and bondage, of exploiters and exploited. Lysias stopped, but I greatly impressed, went on questioning. But how do you account for the state of things? Do these spirits have no defense, no organization? Organization, Lysias proceeded with a smile, is an attribute of organized spirits. You see, the lower zone to which we are referring is like a home where there is no bread. Everybody complains and no one is right. The absent-minded traveler will miss his train. The farmer who does not sow cannot reap. However, of one thing you can be sure, even in the shadows of and ordeals of the lower zone, divine protection never fails its inhabitants. Each spirit remains there just the necessary time, no more, no less. And in order to carry out the work of spirit care in the lower zones, the Lord has permitted the establishment of several settlements such as ours, meaning the astral city. I suppose then, I remarked, that the lower zone must be in close connection with the incarnate plane, even a kind of continuation of it. So it is, he agreed. And you will see there is a net of invisible wires connecting it to the human minds. It is peopled within disincarnated entities and the thought forms of those still on Earth. Every spirit, wherever it may be, is a nucleus radiating forces which can create, transform, or destroy, manifesting as vibrations that Earth science cannot yet understand. Thus, whoever is thinking is emitting positive or negative forces and is consequently constructing or destroying something somewhere. It is by means of those mental currents that men establish connection with entities in the lower zone whose tendencies are in accordance with their own, because every soul is a powerful magnet. You see then that an invisible army is at work behind the invisible one. And I think that's a typo. That should be visible. You see then that an invisible army is at work behind the visible one. The most strenuous missions in the lower zone are assigned to the devoted helpers of the Ministry of Assistance. If a fireman's work in the great cities of Earth is exhausting and dangerous because of the blazing flames and clouds of smoke he has to fight, If a fireman's work in the great cities of Earth is exhausting and dangerous because of the blazing flames and clouds of smoke he has to fight, no lighter is the missionary's task in the lower zone. These missionaries have to withstand heavy fluids emitted from thousands of minds obsessed in the practice of evil or terribly chastised by redeeming ordeals. I tell you, my friend, a great deal of courage and superior capacity for self-sacrifice are necessary to be able to help those who are still unable to understand and appreciate the assistance offered them. As Lysias paused once more, I exclaimed, oh, how would I like to work to help those unhappy creatures, to offer them the spiritual bread of enlightenment. My friendly attendant looked at me kindly and after a few moments of reflection took his leave with this particular remark. I wonder whether you feel duly prepared for such a mission. Yeah, very good. And of course, the sections read were very kind of pretty much correlated with what Scott had just said a few minutes ago, talking about a place where negative mental residues are destroyed and, quote, gradually burned away, unquote. So, basically, yes, it's just a result of man's actions, karmic actions, intentionally or unintentionally or ignorantly on the planet. And he has to go there to actually resolve those issues that he's created for himself in ignoring what he was supposed to do in the first place while he was here on the planet. Scott, what would you like to add to that?
Yeah, there's a lot to say. First of all, it's actually implied pretty clearly that this is not the deepest level of hell or suffering associated with lower realms. This lower realm, for those who turned a deaf ear to the call of their sacred duties, so spiritual apathy, languishing in indecision, but that's not really exactly what gets you there. Dragging themselves into the mire of wrongdoings. What kind of wrongdoings? Well, that's explained a little bit indirectly. You know, there's a lot of verbiage is used here. And it's all in a Christian framework, talking about the Father's work, not in the esoteric perspective of seven chakras or the principles of love-light. Blindly followed the dictates of their own selfishness, continued to cultivate old hates and passions, right? So sensual attachment, but hate. And saying hatred is not justice, passion is not love, yeah. So it's a certain type of wrongdoing. It's associated with hate and passion. Passion is often associated with hate, but passion or desire without hate is more associated with hungry ghost condition. This was clearly shown as adjacent to Earth's physical sphere in the second page on Naraka Buddhism that I sent. Fourth paragraph down says, physically, narakas, meaning these cold and hot hells, are thought of as a series of cavernous layers which extend below the ordinary human world, or Jambudvipa, into the earth, meaning down. And so we're talking about concentric rings, very much like Dante presented it, going down, 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 where the cold is not for the worst of the folks, but the hot levels are for more wicked. And it was explained here, actually, that this is for those that are not of great wickedness, but of a degree of wickedness or perversion. Compact lesions of irresolute, ignorant souls, not wicked enough to be relegated to colonies of harder expiation. Those are the hot hells, the colonies or groupings of those that have a harder or more painful karmic return, nor, of course, sufficiently virtuous to go immediately to higher planes. But he was sufficiently virtuous to later go to the astral city. Not the higher planes, which are above the astral city, but he didn't have to stay there forever. And this Lysias presents basically a Buddhist, you know, a very compatible perspective on the transitory nature of one's after-death experience in the lower realms as being only what's needed with a certain amount of time. As to this notion of burning out the causes, yes and no. It burns off a certain kind of consequence, particularly that these beings are experiencing something akin to the pain they caused others by moderate wickedness, not intense wickedness, but spiritual apathy and basic materialism that leads to selfish behavior in terms of grasping and aversion. We're not talking about hardcore service to self, actually, here. Those are reserved for those beings that I would say are positive at base of beingness, meaning from higher self level, positively oriented essentially, ontologically, and yet did some hardcore service to self activity, that's generally where, those beings generally will go to the lower hells, Naraka, Niraya, the hot hells. Here, we're finding those that are ignorant, are perverse, are basic selfish, with hatred, but they're not disciplined in their hatred in service to self. They're not actually committed to the negative path. In terms of what gets burned out, again, the tendencies that led to a being there will resurface in the next incarnation, are not burned out, actually. The tendencies of selfishness and spiritual apathy or insensitivity to the care, to the feeling of others, because we're talking also about insensitivity to others, using other people for our own pleasure, or a certain sadism, mild sadism, not disciplined in the way of service to self enough, quite, to get to the hot hells. This lower zone is really like the cold hells, it seems. But those tendencies of greed, grasping and aversion and ignorance, they have not been dissolved or healed. But some level of metaphysical consequences being burned off, particularly by experiencing the pain they caused others. But they still are going to have to come to future incarnations. They're still going to have to review and prepare for that in the astral city or wherever they go after this hell. Going to hell is not the same as deep mind purification. It's more of a karmic metaphysical cleansing purification, but the deep mind tendencies still have to be worked through consciously in a further incarnation, and not simply known and forgiven, self-forgiven in the astral city level. And so there's a big deal there. And the final point is associated with thought forms. They're not particularly organized at this level. This is not the same as hardcore service to self, who are organized in certain other astral realms, I think. There are radiatory transmission from all beings and from these beings. So mind is a radiatory energy field. And, you can sense that. When somebody walks in the room, you feel something. Perhaps, if you're sensitive, you would feel their mind, which is what? Virtue or vice. And if you can do that well, you can see who's a liar once they open their mouth. Before they open their mouth, you can see he's service to self or he's a liar, or selfish and materialist or crude or whatever. It can be seen if one can feel the vibratory emanation. And so again, it's hard to go to hell to help them, and yet help is available, and yet they are helpless in the sense that they can't help themselves directly. The only way they can get out is actually willfulness, to call for higher benevolent assistance. And that's how he got out, and that's how other beings get out, and we'll see that later in other chapters going on. Brent?
Thank you, Scott. Yes, very good, very good. Let's move on then. Chapter 44, we're going on to the last chapter in this class, starts on page 196, called The Dark Regions. This is going to explore, Andre learns about the other dark regions, not just lower zones, but the other regions. So we're going to drop to the very bottom of the page, 196, and pick it up there. Basically the last sentence. The governor in his address had mentioned the spheres of earth, the shadowy zone, and darkness. I had never heard any mention of darkness previously. I wondered whether that dark region could be the shadowy zone itself, where I myself had spent several wandering in dense shadows. Weren't there numerous deranged entities and patients of all sorts from the shadowy zone in the chambers, meaning the rectification chambers where he works? And we're going to touch on that and see some examples of individuals in the rectification chambers in class 6 and 7. Remembering that Lysias had given me some valuable information about my own condition on my arrival in the Astral City, I told him of my doubts and questions. With a noteworthy expression on his face, my friend explained, "We call the lowest regions we know darkness. Let's consider all the creatures as travelers in life. A few of them advance resolutely on the way towards the essential object of the journey. These are already spiritually evolved and conscious of the divine essence within themselves. They progress without hesitating toward their sublime goal. Most, however, linger along the road. Numberless souls spend centuries repeating the same experience. While the former advance along straight lines, the latter travel along the same circular path. Thus failing, recommencing, and failing again, they are exposed to endless vicissitudes. Many will go astray in the forest of life, bewildered by the labyrinth they have themselves traced. To that class belong the millions of beings wandering in the shadowy zones. Others, because of their selfish thoughts, walk in the dark and will often fall into precipices where they will remain for an indefinite time. Do you see now?" The explanation could not have been clearer. Impressed by the length and complexity of the subject, I went on with my questions. But what about those falls? Do they only happen on Earth? Are only the incarnate likely to be hurled into the abysses? After a moment's reflection, Lysias replied, "That is a good observation. Wherever he is, the spirit may hurl himself into the abyss of evil. However, in the higher spheres, the defenses are stronger. Therefore, the responsibility of the fault committed is also greater." "Yet," I insisted, "I thought that a fall wouldn't be possible except on Earth. It seemed to me that the divine atmosphere, the knowledge of truth and of higher aid, would be infallible protection against the poison of vanity and temptation." My friend smiled and went on, "The problem of temptation is more complex. The Earth itself is filled with divine atmosphere, knowledge of the truth, and heavenly assistance. Yet so many fight destructive battles while surrounded by sheltering trees and flowering fields. Many others commit murders by moonlight, insensible to the soothing language of the stars. Others oppress the weaker fellow while hearing around them the sublime revelations of truth. Indeed, the earth doesn't lack expressions of divine presence." I'm going to skip a paragraph. "Now, Lysias, could you give me an idea where the region of darkness is located? If the lower zone is connected with the human mind, where is this place of suffering and horror?" "There are spheres of life everywhere," my friend resumed. "The void is merely a literary image. Everywhere there are living forces, and each species of being moves in a special zone of life." After a short pause, during which he seemed to reflect deeply, he went on, "Of course, as happens to most of us, you place the sphere of life after the death of the physical body in the zones right above the surface of the globe, unaware of those below it. Yet life pulsates the depths of the ocean and the bowels of the earth. Besides, the spirit obeys the principles of gravity just as do material bodies. The earth isn't only a field of action which we may disregard and misuse at our will, it is a live organization with certain laws which will either enslave us or set us free, according to our actions. It's obvious that the soul overburdened with faults won't be able to ascend to the surface of the wonderful lake of life. We must bear in mind that free birds may rise to great heights. Those encircled in dense thickets of reeds will find greater difficulty in taking flight, and those tied to great weights become mere slaves of the unknown. Do you grasp my point?" Lysias didn't need to ask that question. All of a sudden, the immense field of the redeeming struggles in the lowermost zones of life seemed to flash before my spiritual eyes. As if in need of carefully weighing his next words, Lysias thought and thought, and then began again. just as we carry in the recesses of our beings the potential for good and evil, so the planet possesses both high and low expressions, with which to correct the guilty and open the passages to life eternal to those who triumph. As a doctor on Earth, you learn that a man's brain contains certain elements which control his sense of direction. Now you realize that those elements aren't really physical, but spiritual in essence. If you live exclusively in the dark, you will dim your divine sense of direction and end by hurling yourself into the shadows. For abysses attract abysses. Each of us shall reach the goal towards which he directs his steps. And that's the end of chapter 44. Excellent points there, correlating exactly with what Scott, you just finished talking about at the end of the last chapter. Comments?
Sure. It's interesting. I mean, Lysias actually doesn't go into detail about the darkness realm. Either he doesn't know it, or he doesn't want to talk about it, or he felt it was more important to analogize it to the, you know, darkness of the potential darkness we may enter by rejecting love and wisdom, by becoming attached to grasping and aversion, becoming attached to desires and selfish tendencies, and particularly competition. You know, a lot of desire and aversion, or desire, grasping, and anger, hatred, is associated with comparing self to other, or looking out and down. This whole distinction between out, down and out, or in and up, is the difference between the worldly and the spiritual, between the materialist and the spiritualist view, between those that keep recycling in the nirayas, cold and hot, or become hungry ghosts, and those that don't. Down and out, in many ways, is associated with lower chakras, as down, below the diaphragm, and out, associated with the overvaluation of the physical, the environmental, the material, the interpersonal, the external. While the spiritual perspective, in and up, is focused on self-transformation and seeking ascension, which really means to seek to develop the higher aspects of our being. And the abyss as a great fall, downfall, and in Buddhism, or Buddhist, the Vinaya rules for the monks, there are actually four or five activities that the monk may engage in that are automatic grounds for automatic expulsion, and they're called downfalls, parajikas. And so Lysias talks about the darkness realm in terms of the darkness potentials of our mind, or the darkness of turning away from love light, or following that which is associated with really down and out, material grasping, and struggling with others as the basis of a downfall. But it's also true that there are hot hells or deeper hells there where a being may actually be in total darkness. And when we look at the hot hells, there are eight of them. There are eight hot hells, eight cold hells, or eight levels of cold and hot. The lower zone is associated with cold, it seems, and the darkness associated with hot. Hot means greater pain. But they're very, you know, they're generally going to be associated with having one's body harmed, and that harm, or that excruciating pain, being unable to stop that for very long. It just goes on and on again and again and again. And this is akin to what Lysias is saying in terms of people who get stuck and go round and round in the darkness. And he's saying there, numberless souls spend centuries repeating the same experience. Failing, recommencing, failing again, exposed to endless vicissitudes, going round and round. That's akin to the wheel of birth and death, samsara, the ocean of birth and death, the wheel of birth and death, going round and round rather than going straight. Akin to going round and round with unhelpful thinking and emotionalism, not being able to cut through. And so, yeah, he's saying, bewildered, many go astray in the forest of life. So this is all poetic language, and poetic language is good, except if you want greater specificity, then you got to leave it and move to a more technical analysis, a more systematic metaphysics like Buddhism and Hinduism, and the raw material. This is not a systematic metaphysics in Nosalar. It's moderately, but it's poetic. It's mainly for people who are trying to get out of third density. It's not written for wanderers, it seems to me. Meanwhile, we can learn a lot from here. Meanwhile, the poetic language is a little flowery for me, but the points are centered. Many go astray in the forest of life, bewildered by the labyrinth they themselves have traced. And so that's the heart of ignorance or avidya, which is creating troubles for oneself. We're all our own worst enemies. We found the enemy, and the enemy is me. We've got to transform mind, as we all know, to move out of suffering. And then going straight, going up, by going in, by focused in, which doesn't mean neglecting the outer, but revaluing the inner and of more value than the outer. You know, worldly ways and pleasures are fine, they're good. You know, all sorts of worldly or relational pleasures and satisfactions and the happiness of intimacy and human life and things are all good, but they won't take you very far up the mountain. They won't. They're flashes in the pan. And they're good? Depends, you know. But if you can make them, particularly relationship, you know, can be evolved to deep spiritual partnership. And so then it's not grasping, it's working together. And that's very different. But it is true that there are millions of beings wandering in the shadowy zones, and then others, because of their selfish thoughts, walk in the dark and fall into precipices where they remain for an indefinite time. They stay in the longer, in the deeper hells, the hot hells. It's understood in Buddhist cosmology that beings stay there longer. And so there are some souls on Earth that probably don't actually go to the astral city. I'm not sure how this book, what it talks about later, you can explain it, but there are beings who repeatedly go between the physical and the lower hells, or both levels of the hell, and have to save themselves. And so the abyss of evil, the falling into the into the abyss, off the precipice, is a whole lot more than basically just selfish, you know, being selfish now and then, but actively using, exploiting, manipulating, dominating, killing others for personal gain or personal pleasure. That level of mind, those qualities of mind are akin to an abyss, because they're very far from love and light. And if you ever met real negative people, they're a real piece of work. They are really sick. That's a sick mind. And, humanity today is being, or society, is being run by the sickest of the minds to some degree. The sickest of the humans are way at the tops of the negative organizations, the secret societies. And we, you know, see that becoming more apparent day by day. But they're backed by Orion, and so there's a lot more going on than Lysias is explaining here. it is certainly in accord with Buddhist cosmology, and from the cold hells or the cold levels of the lower zone that are associated with a desolation and great loneliness and godlessness or a sense of hopelessness, we go to the lower hells or hot or the darkness, like the abyss, off the precipice, that's associated with real torment. And so there is the pain of desolation in the cold, you know, windswept plain where thought form monsters in the sky and sick-minded, perverted, you know, very tormented in mind beings are roaming the plain, to the lower level or the darkness, which is torment of mind and body, and exposure to hardcore sadism in the environment that one has no power to stop, if indeed that is what one had done to others during the space-time incarnation. That's how it's born. That's the cause. So it's pretty bitter. And is there anything else you want to say, Brent, before we close? Because we're at the end of the hour here.
Well, thanks. Just to simply say that I think it's a good perspective. It's a good, as you mentioned, it's an excellent beginner's perspective. And a lot of people that are stuck in third density, or as you mentioned, trying to get out of third density, which is what they should be doing right now, considering we're at the end of this third density cycle. This is some good basic elementary education for those that don't really know. And you're absolutely right. It's very basic. It's more like grade school as far as wanderers are concerned. But I think it's also a really good tool to help individuals, or to even use to help any individuals that wanderers may know that might need, you know, you can subtly turn them on to it, subtly introduce them to this as a basic introduction, and, you know, get their curiosity up, get them thinking about it at least, you know, before we come to the end of the cycle, for sure. And otherwise, that's pretty much it, except that the next class, class three, is going to be, we're going to start doing groups of five chapters so that we can get through the book and the allotted 12 classes. And next we'll be covering chapters 2 through 7, they'll be more condensed. I'll jump around more with the reading so that we are allowed more comment time between the both of us. Mm-hmm. But until then, that's pretty much it for today's class. Scott, do you want to wrap it up?
Yeah, I'll wrap it up. Thank you, and I'm glad you gave a little foreshadowing of next class. That's good to do in your wrap-up statements each time. I just want to put attention to the last paragraphs on the Wikipedia page about Naraka, Niraya, the hells in Buddhism, where it's written that, just to get some sense of the complexity of what's going on with what we call the lower astral, it's written, the sufferings of the dwellers in Naraka, or the cold and hot hells, Niraya, often resemble those of the pretas, or petas, hungry ghost, and the two types of being are easily confused. The simplest distinction is that beings in Naraka, Niraya, the hells, are confined to their subterranean world, while the pretas are free to move about. They're earthbound. These are hellbound, bound in hell. And those who are doing negativity are bound to go there. Then there are also isolated and boundary hells called pratyeka narakas. Pratyeka is like pratyeka Buddha, which is basically different. Pratyeka Buddha and a pratyeka naraka is quite different. Pratyeka means sometimes called solitary hells, and Lokantarikas. So there are all sorts of different options for beings who really indulge in apathy, insensitivity, aggression, passion, harming, exploiting, manipulating, all forms of himsa, all forms of grasping, aversion, ignorance. There are all sorts of available fates in the hells or these two levels of states of woe. And the particular point of being confined to subterranean world, the confinement, the physical or form level confinement, confined in body, in the form, it's an astral body, of the Narakas, cold and hot, both, is a particular aspect of both what these people, what beings, or we, if we get there, which we hope we don't, beings have done to others. There is harm to others that generates helplessness and powerlessness and confinement in mind, boundedness in others, and there's harm that doesn't. And so those that become hungry ghosts or earthbound spirits have some mobility because their harm to others wasn't of such a magnitude that the other was moved into a despair of hopelessness, powerlessness, and confinement. They hurt, but they didn't imprison by their activity the minds of others, minds or body. Those that are in the cold and hot hells, the lower zone and the darkness, imprisoned metaphysically or spiritually or psychologically or emotionally or in some physical way even, others that they were harming. So there are gradations of harming, there are gradations of helping, there are gradations of fourth and fifth and sixth chakra activation, there's kindliness, and there's great self-offering, and there's total self-offering or total surrender to God's will. I just watched the movie again, Beckett, Thomas A. Beckett, Richard Burton, 1964, I think. Great movie, where he was kind of a rogue who turned to God, which was really the honor of following God's will. In his view, that's as well as he understood it, which is fine. Depends on how it plays out. The honor, the self-surrender to obeying the will of God, whatever that may be, which is the same as the will of, you know, love, light, and unity. That's the law of one. And that is all the spiritual qualities we're seeking. That honoring, what honor meant to him then was following the will of God, which is a, you know, Christian, Western, dualistic perspective, which is fine. So long as it's based in morality, as best as it's known. So there are gradations in spiritual understanding as well. And we're trying to get an East-West integration here from Buddhism and Spiritism and the raw material. This is really helpful. So I think there's huge sideboard of smorgasbord offerings of food for thought and spiritual nourishment here. And next time we're going to go out of the lower realms and move on up. And thank you, Brent, for your contribution and for reading it out. I hope everybody was helped. I hope you help yourself by this presentation. Take good care and see you next time. Good night.